Hi, I'd like to welcome you to the Austrian Circle. This is the program where we talk about the economics of freedom here on WHUS Stores 91.7 FM. So thank you so much for tuning into my show this morning. We are going to be talking about central planning on the show today. We're going to be talking about how the state foments plans and puts them into practice and will inevitably fail to meet consumer demand. So in the last episode that I aired to you, we were talking about Star Wars. And in that, we had an article where the author was talking about how when you have a state, it's inevitably going to fail to provide what the people want because the people are demanding that the state do certain things such as keep them safe, make them rich, make them healthy, all of these things. And the state will fail to bring about these goals. And then people ask for the state to do more, and they give more power to the state, thinking that that might bring them what they actually want, when in fact, it just moves them further and further away from their goal because the government then seizes that power and commits to its own preferences at the expense of the public, and then people get poorer and poorer. And this is so important to understand because when we think that the government can accomplish its goals of making us wealthier, we get frustrated when the government doesn't accomplish those goals, and then we give it more and more power to the point where it gets out of control and completely takes over our lives, as has happened so often in history before. This is what happened in the German situation especially, because they were in such hard financial times. The money had been printed so much that it didn't even buy anything anymore. People had to wheel around wheelbarrows of money just to get a loaf of bread. And actually, the wheelbarrow was worth more than the sacks of money that were contained in the wheelbarrow. And so people would steal the wheelbarrow and they'd leave the money because that was worthless. And so people turn to the government and think that it can save them, as a strong leader can bring about some social change that's going to make them more wealthy and more prosperous. But the sooner that we understand that socialist central planning, i.e. government planning, can't possibly work, then the sooner that we can implement real solutions that are actually going to make people more prosperous. So I'd like to start this discussion off by reading an article by Bill Bonner. It was posted on dailyreckoning.com, and it's called Why Central Planning Fails. This was posted in April of 2013, so some of the economic stats might be a little outdated. However, it really does explain to us why central planning can't possibly work, and this is timeless, this concept. The economic incentives are not there to bring about prosperity for people, and so therefore, there is no real way for the government to calculate what it needs to know in order to provide the quality and service that the market would otherwise have provided. Again, this article is called Why Central Planning Fails. The Dow is still rising. It rose another 125 points yesterday, hitting a new record high. Gold is dawdling. We're still thinking about how so many smart people came to believe things that aren't true. Krugman, Stiglitz, Friedman, Bernanke all seem to have a simpleton's view of how the world works. They believe they can manipulate the future and make it better. Not just for themselves, but for everyone. Where did such a silly idea come from? Aristotelian logic came to dominate Western thought after the Renaissance. It was essentially a forerunner of positivism, which is supposedly based on objective conditions and scientific reasoning. "Give me facts," says the positivist, confidently. "Let me apply my rational brain to them. I will come up with a solution." This is fine if you are building the Eiffel Tower or organizing the next church supper. But positivism falls apart when it is applied to schemes that go beyond the reach of the, quote, herald's cry. That's what Aristotle said. He thought only a small community could work at all, because only in a small community would all the people share more or less the same information and interests. In a large community, you can't know things in the same direct personal way, so it's hard for people to work together in the same way. If you have a large community, you have no idea who made your sausage or what they put in it. You have to rely on facts that are no longer verifiable by direct observation or personal acquaintance. Instead, the central planner's facts usually are nothing more than statistical mush, wishful thinking, or theoretical claptrap, the weapons of mass destruction, the unemployment rate, and the Übermensch. Large-scale planning fails because the facts upon which it is built are unreliable, frequently completely bogus. And it fails because people don't really want it. In a small community, the planners and the people they are planning for are close enough to share the same goals. In a large community, the planners are a small minority. In a large community, the planners usually have their own agenda, often a hidden one. They may call for more strict law enforcement while getting campaign contributions from the prison industry. They may seek a cure for cancer and depend on the pharmaceutical industry for job offers. They want a united Europe and hope to be its head man. But though large-scale planning provides almost countless opportunities for corruption, it's not the dirty dealings that dooms it. Instead, it is that the planners don't know or care what people really want, and don't have the means or the information necessary to achieve it anyway. As we have already seen, practically all the public information used by central planners is empty and most often misleading. But the problem is much more basic than the quality of the information or the corruption involved. When we think of what people want, we are not really talking about their conscious, stated desires. We are speaking broadly of what they might be able to get, if allowed to do so, given the facts on the ground. People in hell may want ice cream. They won't get it. But people will do the best they can with what they have to work with. Large-scale central planners can't help them, partly because they don't know what the conditions in the man's private hell really are, and partly because they don't have any ice cream. You might better describe this process of getting as much of what you want as possible as the progress wrought by evolution, where trials and errors result in the best we can do. Not perfect, but not the end of history, just another step toward a future that is unknowable. When you boil it down, large-scale central planners fail because they believe three things that aren't true. First, that they know current conditions, wants, desires, hopes, capabilities, resources. In other words, that they know the exact and entire present state of the community they are planning for. Second, that they know where the community ought to go, that is, that they know what the future ought to be. Third, that they are capable of creating the future they want. None of those things is more than an illusion. Together, they constitute what F.A. Hayek called, quote, the fatal conceit that man is able to shape the world around him according to his wishes. As to the first point, central planners cannot know the current conditions because that would require an infinite amount of information. It would require minute knowledge of 1,000 particulars, which will be learnt by nobody but he who has an interest in knowing them, wrote Samuel Bailey in 1840. The planners have nothing like that. Instead, they have a body of public knowledge, which, as we have seen, is nothing more than popular theories, claptrap, and statistical guesswork. As to the second point, that the central planners are blessed with some gift that tells them what the future should be for complete strangers, we pass over it without argument. No one really believes that people in the U.S. Congress, or the French National Assembly, or in the bureaucracies and think tanks of these nations has anything more to guide him than anyone else, which is to say, only his own likes and dislikes, prejudices and fears, and self-serving ambitions. Of course, each man always does his best, at his own level, to shape his world in a way that pleases him. One will want a fat wife, and likely get one. One will want a fortune, and maybe get it, if he is lucky and diligent. One will want to spend his time playing golf. That, too, may be within his means. Each will try, each will win, lose, or draw, depending upon the circumstances, and the future will happen. The central planner steps in to try to impose his own version of the future. Evolution follows its own course as the plans of individuals and groups succeed or fail. Where evolution is taking us, no one knows. But the large-scale central planner thinks he knows where it ought to go, and he doesn't mind giving it a shove, disrupting the plans of millions of people in the process. As soon as the smallest bits of time and resources are shanghaied for the central planner's ends rather than those of individual planners, the rate of evolutionary progress slows. The trials that would have otherwise taken place are postponed or canceled. The errors that might have been revealed and corrected are not discovered. The future will have to wait. People are easy to deceive, especially when they only have access to, quote, public information. Out of a range of the Herald's voice, they have no more idea of what is going on than the planners themselves. They are encouraged to believe that the collective plans are beneficial. Often they go along with the gag for decades, even as the evidence of their daily lives contradicts its premises and undermines its promises. That was the story in Russia and China after the communist takeovers, where the planners' extravagant schemes endured 70 and 30 years, respectively. But not everyone goes along. When people resist, the planner sees them as obstacles to his success. Ruthless planners then begin purges, cleansings, regulations, famines, deportations, disappearances, tortures, drone attacks, and mass murders to encourage compliance. But their plans are wrecked anyway, because not only do they retard the future, they also don't lead to the outcome the planners expect. Typically, the designers argue that the people must make sacrifices, but that it will all come right in the end. Quote, "You can't make an omelet without breaking some eggs," said Lenin. People go along with breaking a few eggs, particularly if those eggs belong to someone else, for a while. Ultimately, the problem is the omelet itself. It never actually makes it to the table. And the meal that ultimately does arrive is disgusting. No workers' paradise ever happens. The war on drugs or poverty or crime or terror or cancer ends in a defeat, not a victory. Unemployment does not go down. Or if any of these grand programs, quote, succeeds, it does so at a cost that is far out of balance with the reward. Why do these plans fail? The simple answer is because that's not the way the world works. Life on Earth is not so rational that it lends itself to simple-minded, heavy-handed intervention of the naive social engineer. Bridges are designed, so are houses, and particle accelerators. Economies are not. Neither are real languages, customs, markets, love, marriages, children, or any of the other really important things in life. Not to overstate our case, however, it is also true that humans can design and achieve a certain kind of future. If the planners at the Pentagon, for example, decided that a nuclear war would be a good thing, they could bring it about. The effects would be huge, and hugely effective. But this extreme example reveals the only kind of alternative future that the planners are capable of delivering by pulverizing the delicate fabric of evolved, civilized life. It is a future that practically no one wants because it means disrupting the private plans of most of the world's people for marriage, business, babies, baptisms, hunting trips, shopping, investment, and all the other activities of normal life. Stopping those private plans means arresting the particular trials and errors of ordinary people upon which the civilized future depends. Not all central planning produces calamities on that scale, but all, to the extent they are effective, are repulsive. The more they achieve the planner's goals, the more they interfere with private goals, and the more they interfere with the progress of the human race. Again, that article is by Bill Bonner. It was posted on thedailyreckoning.com, and it's called Why Central Planning Fails. So we can see by that article that the central planner assumes a lot of things. They assume to know what people's desires are, what their preferences are, what their emotional status are, what environment they'd love to see come about in the world. They make a lot of assumptions about other people, and ultimately their plans must come at the expense of other people's plans. Ludwig von Mises wrote a lot about planning and said, quote, planning other people's actions means to prevent them from planning for themselves, means to deprive them of their essential human quality, means enslaving them. The planner is a potential dictator who wants to deprive all other people of the power to plan and act according to their own plans. He aims at one thing only, the exclusive, absolute preeminence of his own plan. And this is, again, why central planning can't work. The people who are planning have their own desires and own preferences and desired outcome and all of this stuff. And this will come at the expense of people who have their own plans. And actually, the planning of central planners disrupts the knowledge that is available to people to make better decisions. So when the government takes over energy production, for example, and decides that, well, this is going to be coal, this much is going to be solar, then we're going to do nuclear over here, the people who are most involved in the consumer end of things, they're the ones actually receiving the power, they don't get to see the prices of these various different organizations and what the pros and cons are. So coal gives me this amount of energy at this price, whereas solar gives me this amount of energy at this price, and then I can compare and make choices about what I'd prefer in my own life. But when central planners are involved, I am no longer getting the knowledge that I need about prices and how expensive and costly something is going to be to implement it in my own life. So the next article I would like to read to talk a little bit more about why the government has such a problem meeting the demands of consumers and why people inevitably try and give the government more power, which leads to more problems, which leads to less prosperity, and the vicious cycle continues until society either collapses or there's a huge war or some kind of very destructive occurrence happens. We're going to turn to the Foundation for Economic Education and an article by Alex Salter called Economics and the Calculation Problem. Can a rationally planned economic order outperform the market process as a means of using resources efficiently? This is the central question behind one of the most important debates of the history of economic thought. Its answer has profound implications for the material well-being of societies. By the early 1900s, economists were in broad agreement on the free exchange system's effectiveness in bringing about an efficient use of resources. Despite this, the system did not want for enemies. Marx and his disciples disparagingly called it the capitalist mode of production, though the word capitalist actually derived from free market critics of mercantilism. Dissidents accused the system of leading to socially detrimental outcomes in the form of market power wielded by large businesses and recurring cycles of boom and bust. Critics maintained that these shortcomings were the inevitable result of an anarchic system of production. However, if the means of production were brought under rational control, these deficiencies could be avoided. Combined with expert management state socialism, the system characterized in theory by collective ownership of the means of production, would result in increased material abundance and a more socially just distribution of wealth. In 1920, the Austrian economist Ludwig von Mises took on the critics in his essay, quote, Economic Calculation in the Socialist Commonwealth. Mises explained that the largest challenge facing any economic order was the employment of capital goods, things like machines and factories, whose purpose was to make other goods for final consumption. This insight has important implications for deciding not only what goods to produce, but also how these goods should be produced. For example, if a railroad company wants to build a new branch line, should it use steel or titanium rails? both projects are technologically feasible, but only a working price mechanism conveys that, at the margin, titanium is much more expensive than steel, meaning titanium should be saved for more urgently desired and thus higher yield investment projects. Socialism, by collectivizing the ownership of capital goods, necessarily destroys the market in which these goods are traded, thus making rational economic calculation impossible. With no markets for the factors of production, there can be no prices for the factors of production. With no prices for the factors of production, it is impossible to discern which lines of production are profitable. With no information regarding profitability, nobody could properly determine what goods to produce, nor how to produce them. Given these informational difficulties, Mises explained, it would be impossible for socialism to produce material abundance to the same degree as the free exchange system. Mises' claim was fiercely debated in academic circles in the 1920s and 1930s. Socialist intellectuals came to accept that some sort of price system is necessary for the rational use of resources. However, these intellectuals did not endorse the free exchange system. Instead, economists such as Oscar Lange and Adam Lerner maintained that as long as there is a market in final consumers' goods, a socialist planning board could use the prices that emerged on that market to discern the correct use of capital goods. For example, by allowing the price mechanism to function in the market for chocolate, socialist planners could use the resulting price of chocolate to impute the appropriate prices for goods used to produce chocolate, such as cocoa and mixers. Using the consumer goods prices as data, socialist planners could construct a system of equations of costs and revenues. Next, they could solve that system for the efficient quantity of a given good, which could be produced in a way that minimized costs. In this way, the socialists could have their cake and eat it too. They could keep a functioning price mechanism, which would ensure the generation of data needed to allocate resources efficiently, and also organize production in a way that would avoid the inefficiencies and inequities of the capitalist system. Leading the charge against this particular brand of socialism was F.A. Hayek, who was Mises' greatest student and a towering figure in theoretical economics in his own right. Hayek pointed out a grave flaw in the socialists' models. They assumed they had all the relevant information to solve the equations. In fact, this information is dispersed throughout the economy and does not exist in any single mind or group of minds. Often this information takes the form of specialized knowledge, such as local business conditions or subjective value rankings, which by its very nature could not be quantified in the socialists' equations, but was still indispensable for resource allocation. Furthermore, market transactions are not a one-way information system, as the socialists presume. Individuals use prices as knowledge surrogates when they make their decisions, and when they trade in the market, they feed their own knowledge back into the price system for others to utilize. Hayek famously used the example of tin. If the price of tin rises, consumers do not need to know why, out of the infinite number of possibilities, this occurred. All he needs to know is that tin is more expensive, which means he must give up more resources to acquire the same quantity as before. He is led to economize on tin, saving what amount remains for uses that bring a greater return. By divorcing market prices from the process by which they are generated, Hayek argued, the market socialist robbed prices of any meaningful epistemological content, so their solution failed on its own terms. Unfortunately, Hayek's arguments were either ignored or misinterpreted. By the 1940s, it was widely agreed that the defenders of free exchange had been soundly defeated. Central planning could allocate resources efficiently as long as a few key aspects of a market system were retained. As a consequence, the various experiments with central planning in the communist nations of the mid-20th century were given intellectual legitimacy. Statistics detailing massive production of capital goods such as steel and concrete poured out of those countries' economic bureaus, which seemed to give empirical confirmation to the supremacy of socialist production under central planning. All the while, many of the world's leading economists, including Nobel laureate Paul Samuelson, pointed to cases such as these when instructing new economic students. In the end, Mises and Hayek were vindicated in no less grand a forum than the world political stage. By the 1980s, it was obvious that living standards of citizens in communist countries were far below those of citizens in countries which had retained, more or less, the free exchange system. The increased internal unrest in the Soviet Union became increasingly hard to ignore. The collapse and formal dissolution of the Soviet Union in December 1991 demonstrated once and for all the contradictions inherent in non-market allocation schemes. Only market-guided resource use, the system of free exchange, could lead to widespread material abundance. Any attempt to suppress this system, however well-intentioned, was doomed to bring about nothing but lower standards of living. Ultimately, the socialist calculation debate demonstrates the incredible importance of ideas in shaping the course of societies. Only if the crucial insights discovered by luminaries such as Mises and Hayek are accepted and put into practice, societies can continue to prosper. That article was by Alex Salter, and it was called Economics and the Calculation Problem. It was posted on the Foundation for Economic Education. So thank you again for tuning in. This has been the Austrian Circle. We have been talking about central planning and the problems that occur when government tries to presume to have knowledge that it does not have. When it says its plans are important and needs to be implemented, this comes at the expense of other people's plans who would have used those resources in a different way. When the government confiscates resources for something such as war, then those resources are not spent on what people would have otherwise privately planned for. They aren't invested into new businesses, they aren't put into bridges or roads or schools or new organizations to make our lives better. They are sent to the government and then used for whatever plans the government has in place at the expense of other people's plans. And because this is a coercive relationship, we actually don't know if those people contributing to the war funds actually want the war to occur. When the government forces people to give it money, there's no way to see that people actually wanted the outcome of whatever it is that the government generates. And so we have a lack of knowledge that occurs whenever there's a planning by a central body of people, such as a government or a central planning board or any of those kind of things. And we don't get the market system, which is constantly fluctuating with new knowledge of consumer preference and demand. And producers have to react to that new knowledge that they get. When prices rise in a particular area, that means that consumers have more demand in that area, or the supply of a resource is going down in that area. So we have to rush in to try and provide more of it. And so prices and profits show us a lot of information that central planners simply do not have access to, and we gain our prosperity from the understanding of the world around us and the knowledge that the market system gives to us. So again, this has been a presentation of the Austrian Circle. Thanks so much for tuning in, and we will be back next week. Have a great week. Take care.